بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعه واهتدى بهديه واستنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين. In the name of Allah, the All Merciful, the Ever Merciful, and all praise and the blessings of Allah be upon all the prophets and messengers from Adam عليه السلام to Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. All the praise and the blessings of Allah be upon the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, his household and his companions. Inshallah, we will get started now. That's the first seerah session or life of the Prophet session after Ramadan. We finished 8 parts, and basically the 8 parts we went through in a very intensive way. Tons of information, tons of knowledge, tons of history from before the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, by understanding the social, the religious, the political context of the Arabian Peninsula back in the time in the 7th century and before that AD. And also we learned a little bit about the birth of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the early childhood of the Prophet, and then after this his marriage, and after that the early encounters with the revelation and his message. And also we learned through that the 3 years of secret da'wah or preaching among the companions, and the early companions or the early Muslims, their characteristics and their own understanding of Islam and how they've been seeing things. And also we learned that how can we understand our brothers and sisters who convert to Islam, and how they can relate their struggles to the early Muslims. Also, we learned about the struggles of early Muslims in terms of persecution. They have been experiencing a lot of persecution from their families, their masters, the people around them. And also we moved on to talk about the public preaching. And then after the public preaching, we learned the tortures that happened against the Prophet, against the companions as well. And we learned about the 2 immigrations to Abyssinia or Ethiopia, modern day Ethiopia and Eritrea and Somalia. And then after that, we move to talk about the first encounters with the people of Yathrib. It's a city north around 330 miles north of Mecca. And when the people of Yathrib accepted Islam, and then they welcomed the Prophet, and then they had 2 pledges with him, and then the Prophet immigrated to Yathrib, or what's known later on as Medina of the Prophet, or the city of the Prophet. We stopped at the first things that the Prophet did when he went to Yathrib or Medina. The first thing he did is building the masjid, building the first masjid the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam built. Actually, he built the first masjid was in Quba, that's a city south of Medina, and then he built the house, the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that was like the center of everything. That was like a masjid, that was a government building, that was like almost everything, meeting delegations coming from different tribes and all of these things. And also we learned that the Prophet made the brotherhood between the people who come from Mecca, the immigrants that came from Mecca without anything, and the people who came to Medina, the people of Medina, and how we see that, how special these people were. Also, we talked about the writing of the constitution of Medina, or al-wathiqa, or al-sahifa, or the accord, or the scroll, or you call it the constitution of Medina, that has almost roughly around 50 articles, and the whole Medina agreed together that everybody will protect everyone. The inhabitants of Medina were polytheists, were agnostics, not religious, were Muslims, and majority Muslims and Christians and Jews. But we didn't have a lot of references to Christians, but we know that there are 3 main tribes of Jews were inhabitants of Medina. And also we learned a little bit about the nature of the Jews of Medina, that and the nature of Jews that were the current of the Jews of the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and what kind of special about them. So not to kind of like have a gross generalizations and be trapped in the misunderstandings that's common among a lot of people. So we stopped here at the constitution of Medina. Inshallah, today we will move on to talk about the first 2 years of the life of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, roughly in Medina. And we would talk about the first physical encounters with the Meccans and the other people, and we learn about the concept of jihad as well. We will learn about what is the concept of jihad, what that means, and how it's been initiated in Islam, and what's that mean, because that's one of the biggest misunderstood concepts, that almost the whole world know what jihad, what that word is. They know this word, like if you say that word in front of everybody, everyone knows it. But you might see a few people who understand what this word exactly and truthfully means, and why, and what is the context of it. Everybody knows the text, and why I call it the problem of the text without the context, or the problem of uprooting, or like taking off the context of the text. That's one of the biggest complexities that a lot of people will see, and a lot of people have, regardless what, some of them are Muslims, some of them are not Muslims, and that's the problem of this. Inshallah, we'll discuss this details, because that's when this period of time, the first 2 years, when we first see in the Quran, that see some revelations related to jihad or killing or fights. And we will know exactly what that means and the context of each one of them. There's a really beautiful book that's called Al-Qital fi al-Quran, written by one of the late Grand Imam of Al-Azhar. Sheikh Mahmoud Chaltut, he got all the verses in the Quran that talks about fights and explained each and every one of them context. And that was a really nice book. It's like 50 pages. I know it in Arabic, but I'm not sure if it has an English translation. There are so many things, inshallah, we talked about this in details, but I don't want to talk about details, but I'm going to talk about the concept of it and give a perspective of the context of the first 2 years in the Medina period, or in the Medina of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Let's go ahead and get started. I have a very short time, so inshallah I'm going to stick to finish until 7:30, and I hope I finish at that, because that's one of the feedback that I appreciate, that a lot of people told me about, to try to keep it to 7:30 and focus more on the quality and not the quantity of the presentation. But the seerah of the Prophet is really big, and it's really nuanced. So the life of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, 2 years in Medina. The main point of today is the universal law of checking certain people by means of another certain people. That's someone called Muhammad Ali Sallabi talked about it, and we discuss it slightly. Preparing the Muslims for fights and jihad, and we will talk about this in details. The goal of jihad at the time of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, famous expeditions, and also we learn slightly about how many expeditions or battles happened in the life of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in the 11 years of Medina expeditions, and also we learn about expeditions or battles or expeditions before Badr al-Kubra. Badr al-Kubra is that's when we're going to stop. That's the first big expedition that's turned to be a big fight between the Muslims and Meccans. It's called Badr al-Qital, or Badr of the fight. So let's go ahead and start. The universal law of checking certain people by means of another certain people. What that means? It means one of the first, according to Ibn Kathir, one of the scholars of exegesis or tafsir, he talked about that verse, أُذِنَ لِلَّذِينَ يُقَاتَلُونَ بِأَنَّهُمْ ظُلُمُوا وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَى نَصْرِهِمْ لَقَدِيرٌ. Permission to fight has been given to those who are being fought because they were wronged. And indeed, Allah is a competent to give them victory. One of the things that we need to understand, the concept of jihad, my brothers and sisters, there are two concepts of jihad. So the concept of jihad is the jihad to the self. Jihad, as Ibn al-Qayyim said it, jihad to the self, like it means literally to strive. The word jihad, it means to strive to something, or to be devout to something, or to endeavor something. So to strive to be a better person, that's called the jihad al-nafs, or the inner jihad. Also, we have another one, strive with the Satan, shaitan. That's also an external jihad. And you have another one is jihad, strive for justice. And that's the one that we're talking about that unfortunately has been misunderstood as a holy war. There's nothing called holy war in Islam. It's called the just war and unjust war. That's the meaning of it. There is nothing called harb muqaddasa in Islam or holy war, as it's been known among Western scholars and Orientalists, that they applied their own understanding of a holy war by the word on the word of jihad. That's completely wrong and incomplete, and that's the problem of a single story that's been spread out by Islamophobic and unfortunately extremists. So when the Prophet ﷺ moved to Medina, you're talking about now a time that the Meccans and Quraysh and their clans and the clans that have treaties with Quraysh, now they are inconsistent and prolonged enmity to the Muslims. Who are the Muslims? The Muslims who are Meccans and moved to Yathrib, so now they have enmity to the people in Medina, regardless whether they're coming from Mecca and not. And that's why you will see this in the constitution of Medina, that they were saying, stating clearly that any attack will happen or will take place against Medina should not be tolerated, and the all inhabitants of Medina should fought for the safety and security and the protection of Medina. So now the Muslims are in a very severe dangers and a very dominant dangers by Quraysh and Ghatafan and other tribes, and we know that they are based in a very trivial system that's widely spread among the Arabian. So when the Muslims are here in Medina, so they are in danger from all the surrounding or majority of the surrounding tribes and clans and cities. Okay, so that would give you a perspective that now you are in a context that has been completely transgressors to you. Okay, the social context and the political context as well. Inside Medina, they are hypocrites. That why would a person be a hypocrite? And we didn't have that problem in Mecca, because in Mecca nobody would not be forced to be a hypocrite because Muslims are a minority. So a person to make a person a hypocrite or a person to choose the route of hypocrisy is in two ways. One, that person doesn't want to show what they believe in because they will lose certain interests, or they have some interest in being Muslims or not Muslims, whatever. And number two, that person is coward to show what they believe in. And that, but even though at Medina there are other people that were not Muslims at all, and they did accept Islam, and we have narrations in the Hadith and some narrations talking about this, that there are people in Medina, they are not Muslims, and they were not even forced to be Muslims at all. So that's the idea of the universal law of checking certain people by means of other people, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made these early Muslims be in a context that's really dangerous for them. So they have to have two ways. One way is to protect themselves through treaties, to make treaties among the other tribes around them, like do something like the Accord or the Constitution of Medina that the Prophet did with the inhabitants of Medina, to do it with the neighboring tribes and clans. That's one of them. The other one is to make sure that they are uprooting the source of animosity and the source of danger that is based in Mecca. Okay, so that's one thing. When the Muslims are starting, Muslims were not obliged or they were not instructed to fight back at all in Mecca. In Medina now they started to get stronger and they need to protect themselves, and they will talk in details inshallah about the concept of jihad or the purpose of jihad. So these are some of the early verses that talked about this, and one of the early verses that also were revealed in Medina. So if you see the verses, look at this. Permission to fight has been given to those who are being fought, have been fought because they were wronged. So fighting here is a way to, or fighting for justice is a way to bring people that have been wronged, to bring the justice to them. That's one. And then more explanation said in the next verse in the Quran, الَّذِينَ أُخْرِجُوا مِنْ دِيَارِهِمْ those who have been evicted from their homes without a right, بغير حق, إِلَّا, only because they say, our Lord is Allah, إِلَّا يَقُولُ رَبُّنَ اللَّهِ وَلَوْلَا دَفْعُ اللَّهِ, and were it not that Allah checks the people, some by means of others, there had been demolished monasteries, sawama, churches, synagogues, and mosques eventually. So look at the verse, look at how it's been instructed, how been structured together, in which the name of Allah is much mentioned, and Allah will surely supply those who support him. Indeed, Allah is powerful and exalted in might. So that two verses, or these two verses in the Quran, tells us that the point of fights are for justice. The point of jihad, as like the fights that the people misunderstood it, is for bringing justice and defending people. And that's the biggest context of Medina that was widespread among them that time. So when we understand the battles or the expeditions of the Prophet ﷺ, we need to understand them of these two verses context, okay? And to understand them in the 7th century social and political and religious context as well. That sounds fine, because that will shed a lot of light, and that will clean a lot of misconceptions and dismantle them completely. Without understanding this, we will not be able to completely understand. And the dangers here, the dangers that I would call it, is the incomplete single story that people promote, or some people promote, whether Islamophobic or extremist. Also, وَقَاتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ الَّذِينَ لَيُقَاتِلُونَكُمْ وَلَا تَعْتَدُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُعْتَدِينَ. One of the earliest verses in the Quran talking about actual, complete, and explicit fighting. Fight in the way of Allah. Those who fight you. So when you fight, that means you fight someone who's fighting you. But do not transgress. That's the big thing. Indeed, Allah does not like transgressors. Allah does not like transgressors. So, also one of the verses, the early verses that are talking explicitly about that, because I'm giving more time in these verses? Because I'm giving more time in these ayat or these verses, because that will explain to us the expeditions that will happen. We have almost 95 expeditions. The Prophet participated in 27 of them, and in some narrations, 28. And there were nine of them, I think, that the Prophet participated in, where there was a fight. We'll talk this inshallah in details later on. So you see that verse as well, because these are some of the verses that people misunderstood. وَقَاتِلُوا الْمُشْرِكِينَ كَافَ كَمَا يُقَاتِلُونَكُمْ كَافَ. That says, and fight against the disbelievers collectively as they fight against you collectively, and know that Allah is with the righteous whom he fear him. Some people would say, like for example, yesterday, like just yesterday, I was in a conversation with someone, and that person tells me, I understand, you know, like in the Quran, it says fight the unbelievers and kill all the infidels. I told him, how do you get that source? He said that that's mentioned in the Quran in that chapter. And yeah, it's mentioned in the Quran, but did you go to the verse before it and the verse after it? And did you check the reasons of revelation? Of course not. Because I can cut and paste, fight against I can cut and paste now, fight against the disbelievers collectively. That's it. I cut it. And then I go out there and say, look at what Islam tells the Muslims in the Quran. But not to understand the context of it, that Muslims were required to fight courageously and bravely, otherwise they were going to be killed. They're going to be extinguished. And we know this in the context, by the way. Like, for example, someone called Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, I think, or Sa'd ibn Ubadah, one of the leaders of the Medina people, he went to Mecca and he wanted to go in tawaf or surround the Kaaba, circle around the Kaaba. So he was afraid. So he asked one of the people of Mecca, his name is Umayy ibn Khalaf, to do this, like to go one time when it's dark, to clear the way for him so he can do that without the Meccans see him. So anyway, he met someone called Abu Jahl or Hakam ibn Hisham. And Abu Jahl, when he saw him, he told him, are you the ones who took or escorted or bring a safe haven for the people who have been left Mecca? I swear to Allah, we are going to kill you from one to two. We're going to kill you, all of you, and we're going to hold your women hostages and prisons and all of these things. So there's a lot of things that happen. And also we will see also that some people came to Medina to get some sheep and all of that. So the Muslims have to be strong and have to be completely strong. Otherwise, because that's, I would say to people, Islam is not a pacifist religion. It's not asking people to be completely like dervishes and just not away from the context. Islam is asking Muslims to be strong and educated and civilized and courageous and brave and fight for justice and fight for the cause of justice, like what's happening now in George Floyd. That's something that's an explicit murder, that all Muslims are required to fight for that justice. As well, Muslims are required to fight for the justice in Palestine, in India, in Central Africa, in Kashmir, in all over the world. Muslims are required to fight for the justice regardless the person has been wronged as a Muslim or not. Okay, so that's something that's really prominent that we need to understand in these contexts. Number E, or letter E, wa'iddu lahum, this verse is really important. Prepare against them whatever you are able of power and of steeds of war by which you may terrify the enemy of Allah and your enemy. So that's also in the context that early on in the first two verses, or the first 2 years in Islam, in Medina, the Muslims are required to be prepared physically, emotionally, spiritually, religiously, to be prepared because there's a lot of fights and the struggles are coming in. There's a lot of things, a lot of attacks, a lot of defense needed at this time. It's like, because that's a newborn state that was born completely rare style, in a rare style, unlike what's been known among Arabs in the 7th century. The Arabs have been clustering together based in their genealogy or based in their families and clans. Now this is a state that's born based in faith and connected faith that carries among them, even though there was diversity among the inhabitants of Medina, regardless of whether they're Jews or polytheists or not Muslims or Muslims and so on and so forth. Even though it's one of the early verses in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he says in the Quran, La ikraha fi din, the one that's the everybody state, no, there's no compulsion in religion. Do you know the reason of revelation of that verse? The reason of revelation of that verse, that there were some of the Ansar, some of the companions of the Prophet, the fathers, the older generation, they became Muslims, but their sons converted to Judaism a long time or sometime before the Prophet immigrated to Medina. So when the Prophet immigrated to Medina and became Muslims, they wanted to force their sons to become Muslims and not to become Jews. This verse was revealed to tell them, no, there's no compulsion religion. People have to come to the faith in from their heart, not from the sword. So the point of the idea of expansion, or the idea of holy war to kind of like force people to become Muslims, it's completely unbased, it's completely refuted, is not historically, and is not completely based in anything other than just a phobic understanding or selective understanding of the verses in the Quran and the history of the Medina. So let me check the time. Okay, I'm running out of time actually. Prepare Muslims to fight for jihad. So now we talked about jihad. Why is it misunderstood? We talked about this. Why do some people take ayat at superficial level? I would say because of ignorance, or because of some people are really smart and they're not ignorant, but because of promoting certain agendas or certain things. So some people do that. There was like a huge, vicious, malicious war against Muslims and against Islam in general after the 9/11 that stuck in 2011. And it was like something like they spent tons of money. Billions of dollars are being spent in promoting the agenda of Islamophobic among many people in the West, and even training Muslims to misunderstand the religion and think of it as kind of like incomplete or something. That's one of the things, the complexity of the text without the context. We talked about this. Also, what was the context of the Arabs and Muslims in Medina? We talked about that as well. And we talked about the incidents of Sa'd ibn Mu'adh and Abu Jahl and the explicit enmity and the dangers that Muslims were expecting from everyone around them. And we will learn this, inshallah, when we dig deeper. So the spiritual guidance of this is why there was so much, this is why, with understanding the context, this is why you will see a lot mentions or some words mentioned about jihad, or some words mentioned about the significance of fighting and the significance of defending yourself and the bravery and all of these things. Muslims are not required to be completely weak and just sided in the corner. No, that's not something. That's complete, and that's actually a common thing. That's even been adopted by the United Nations Charter 1945 when they declared that no state should resort to war unless they already depleted from all the peaceful ways. And when a state is being attacked, they have the all right to defend themselves by war. So that's exactly what the concept of it. This is why there's so much physical training that was going on. The Prophet was encouraging people to learn how to thrust with a spear, strike with a sword, shoot with a bow and arrow, or riding on horses. Caution from enemies as well was very highly pressed and emphasized. يَا الَّذِينَ أَمَنُوا خُذُوا حِذْرَكُمْ فَانْفِرُوا ثُبَاتٍ أَوْ انْفِرُوا جَمِيعًا. Oh, you have believed, take your precaution and either go forth in companies or go forth together. Preparing the soul as well to sacrifice, because that's something that if you remember the second pledge of Aqaba, or the pledge between the Prophet Muhammad and the people of Medina before the Prophet immigrated, he took a pledge from them for what? For their souls. They took a pledge to protect him for the extent that they die for it. So there's a lot of things that were expected, because understanding the 7th century context will help us a lot to understand a lot of the verses in the Quran that talks about that, or they are complicated for people at the first glance. So prepare the soul to make sacrifices and detach itself from worldly inclinations. So this is why Allah says in the Quran, Allah has purchased from the believers their lives and their properties. And let me tell you something, without the true and sincere belief of these early Muslims, we wouldn't find Islam today. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows, like for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes these people as the reasons to transmit Islam to us. This is why they are our example in terms of that, because they were sincere. That with the person of them, the second they become Muslim, they became completely sincere in their faith, and they are not worried so much about even the lives, which is the most precious thing for a human being, to protect their lives. We have preparing the soul as well to make sacrifices and detach itself from its inclination. Like, look at these verses. These verses will explain to us. These verses mention Surah Al-Imran, the third chapter in the Quran. And look at this. إِنْ يَمْسَسْكُمْ قَرْحٌ فَقَدْ مَسَّ الْقَوْمَ قَرْحٌ مِثْلُهُ وَتِلْكَ الْأَمْثَالُ وَتِلْكَ الْأَيَامُ نُدَاوِلُهَا بَيْنَ النَّاسِ وَلِيَعْلَمَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَيَتَّخِذَ مِنْكُمْ شُهَدَاءَ وَاللَّهُ لَا يُحِبُّ الظَّالِمِينَ. If a wound should touch you, there has been touched the opposing people a wound similar. And look at the end of ayah. Look at the end of the verse. And Allah does not like the wrongdoers. Look at this word. Look at this end. And keep going. And Allah may purify the believers, okay, and destroy the unbelievers. Or do you think that you will enter paradise where Allah has not yet made evident those of you who fight in His cause and made evident those who are steadfast? وَلَمَّا حَسَّ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَيَمْحَقَ الْكَافِرِينَ أَمْ حَسِبْتُمْ أَن تَدْخُلُوا الْجَنَّةَ وَلَمَّا يَعْلَمِ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا مِنْكُمْ وَيَعْلَمَ الصَّابِرِينَ. And those who are patient, and keep going. وَلَقَدْ كُنْتُمْ, and you had certainly wished for martyrdom. Remember the pledge of Aqaba that they wished for martyrdom before? You encountered it. Now you're encountering it. Muhammad is not but a messenger. Other messengers has passed on before him. If he was to die or killed, would you turn back in your heads? Look at these verses. Look, you teaching Muslims or preparing them that there's no detachment to any life inclinations, even the Prophet himself. There's a message that you need to stick to it, and you need to have freedom to do that. So we will go to that part of it. The goal of jihad at the time of the Prophet, protecting the freedom of the believers to worship Allah. So that one of the goals of striving for the sake of Allah, or in the cause of Allah, or what's known as jihad, is to protect people to protect people's freedom. So if I go to a demonstration now, asking for justice for the people, or for our brothers and sisters who are dark skinned or brown or black or something, that's the type of jihad that I'm going in front of everybody, telling them that this is wrong and the people need to be free. And one of the biggest freedom of people is to free to move, free for life, pursuit of life and pursuit of happiness, as they call it in American Constitution. Also protecting places of worship. As we said before, if the people are not tried or checked by the certain other people, the first buildings will be destroyed is synagogues, monastery, churches, and eventually mosques. Also, it's a testing and training and improving spirituality of the believers. Also exposing hypocrites, dismantling the threats and dangers of polytheists, because they were not just, because there are two types of people who are not Muslims. There are one, people are not Muslims, they're just like not Muslims, they don't believe, and that's their freedom to not to believe. But there are people who are actually attacking and asking these, or completely like killing these Muslims for no reason. This is why freedom fighters, or the concept of freedom fighters, it's something that's known in Islam and something encouraged in Islam to fight for your freedom. Dismantling the threats and dangers of polytheists, defending the Medina and protecting its borders as well. So look at these United Nations two ones that, inshallah, we end up with this. All members should settle their international disputes by peaceful means in such a manner that international peace and security and justice are not endangered. International peace, security, and justice are not endangered. Nothing in the present charter shall impair the inherent right of individual or collective self-defense if an armed attack occurs against a member of the United Nations. And that's a United Nations charter that has been adopted by almost the whole world. So, inshallah, we'll end up here because of our time. And as I promised not to take a lot of time, and I took 6 minutes, so that's okay. So if you have any questions or anything, please let me know, and then we continue, inshallah. We'll start from here about talking. So now we kind of like built the basis of the concept of jihad, built the basis of the idea of the context of the Muslims. And inshallah, starting from next session, we'll talk about the famous expeditions that happened at the Prophet, at the time of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and we'll talk about other expeditions as well. So if you have any questions or anything, please go ahead and you can write in the chat box. You can text in the chat box, please, and I will be more than happy to answer any questions. Otherwise, inshallah, we'll end up at this point. Okay, so I guess there are no questions. So inshallah, we'll end up at this. And I hope that will kind of like clear out some misconceptions that people might understand about some of the verses in the Quran and the context of them. Jazakumullah khair, and assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.